Disaffection with Buhari had been evident for months.
Well, Buhari has not delivered the goods. He has
continues to be economically and politically disrupted by the mass movement of workers expelled from Nigeria.
He has not come up with a comprehensive economic policy. He has built himself into a corner.
Buhari has to do with the human rights administration.
While money is missing, then set up inquiry.
And you are killing many people. If you don't go, your life is at risk. Whether you like it or not, you should leave.
While money is missing, 2.8 billion.
The impression that was created in the minds of people in the time of Buhari, especially Buhari and Ijabo, was that this the time to be sober, the time not to smile.
2.8 billion naira. Oil money is missing. 2.8 billion naira. Oil money is missing.
When Buhari said ruthlessly, he meant it. During the 41-year-old Major General's time in power, Nigerians came to understand what it meant to live in fear.
He was the once quietly disposed secondary school classmate of Sheikh Musa Yar'Adua, the charismatic number two man in the Obasanjo military dictatorship and elder brother to the late President Umaru Musa Yar'Adua. Sheikh Yar'Adua died ignobly in suspicious circumstances at the hand of the dreaded General Sani Abacha, whose government he served as the chairman of Abacha's Petroleum Trust Fund, PTF. It is on record that Yar'Adua shared a dormitory with Muhammadu Buhari, thus commencing a lifelong but not always easy friendship. With Buhari, Yar'Adua joined the school cadet corps. He is Muhammadu Buhari, retired Army Major General and former military dictator who overthrew the civilian administration of Alhaji Sheikh Aliyu Shagari barely 14 weeks into Shagari's second term in office. Since Nigeria's return to democracy in 1999, the perennially stone-faced, ashen-looking, cold-staring general has emerged from obscure political wilderness and self-imposed public exile, as epitomized by his tight-lipped silence in the dreaded years of the Abacha draconian dictatorship, to become the nation's perennial presidential aspirant. Buhari's name is the recurring decimal of presidential elections since 2003. 2015 is Buhari's fifth shot at the Nigerian presidency. The first in 1993 was successful through the barrel of a gun when he overthrew a democratically elected government, but all others have failed at the ballot box. When Buhari took over, he detained Bisi Onabanjo of Ogun State, Kayode Latif Jakonde, aka Baba Kekere of Lagos State, Sam Mbakwe, Imo State, Ape Aku, Benue State, and Professor Ambrosali of the defunct Bende State, now Edo and Delta States. These were men who were regarded as arguably the best performing governors of the Second Republic. These men were plagued by terrible diseases while in prison. Professor Ambrose Ali and Samuel Bakwe died prematurely. Ambrose Ali came out of Buhari's prison blind. Ambrose Ali was so poor that the Edo State government had to build him a befitting house after his death so as to hold a decent burial. General Buhari impounded the official passport of Papa Obafemi Awolowo and denied the old man visits to his doctors at Mayo Clinic, Royster, Minnesota. Under Buhari's regime, anyone could be detained at his whim using draconian decrees. The list of those incarcerated under Buhari's regime is lengthy. Sam Mbakwe, Fela Kuti, Femi Aribisala, Bisi Onabanjo, Bola Ige, Audu Obe, and so many others. Individual security was so bad under Buhari that when Pa Adekunle Ajashin was acquitted twice by courts that found him not guilty of Buhari's accusation of corruption, the Buhari regime rearrested and detained him under decree number 2. While Buhari detained Tai Solari and denied him medication, even while Tai Solari was having persistent asthmatic attacks. Specifically, due to his criticisms of the successful military administrations, he incurred the wrath of the Buhari regime and became a victim of its much dreaded State Security Detention of Persons Decree No. 2 of 1984. Disturbed by the violation of his fundamental human rights, Solari, through his lawyer, Dr. Olu Onagoruwa, filed a writ of habeas corpus at the Lagos High Court, seeking the detainee's production in court and Solari's subsequent release. The court ruled in Solari's favor, and by this ruling, the court invalidated the detention order under which Solari was incarcerated. In 1983-84, Buhari protected Anwar Ibrahim, the MPN Niger State Governor, who was arrested in Heathrow Airport in London with £14 million and several millions of naira and dollars. He was never persecuted. Buhari protected Shehu Kangiwa, MPN Sokoto State Governor, who conducted and supervised the famous Bakolori massacre of poor peasant farmers whose lands were appropriated without compensation. Buhari engineered the scrapping of one of the most foresighted policies of the UPN Latif Jakonde-led civilian government of Lagos State when he took over, which was the desire to improve transportation in Lagos and regenerate the city, which was the federal capital at the time. In 1982, the Jakonde government signed a $700 million contract for the Metroland project with a French consortium comprising of about 19 firms. The Lagos State government was required to pay only 10% of this money, while the balance was to be paid by the consortium. But Buhari scrapped the project, and Nigeria forfeited $60 million already deposited for the project. Even worse, Buhari ordered the judicial murder of Bernard Ogedegbe, who was sentenced to death under Decree 20 for a crime he committed before Decree 20 was enacted, whereas he carried a lighter sentence when he committed the crime. Buhari refused to accept any pleas to spare Ogedegbe's life. Hence, under Buhari, the state denied the individual his life at the whim of General Buhari. To summarize the state of security under Buhari's regime, Professor Wole Soyinka expressed shock that any Nigerian would ever contemplate voting for Buhari as a president. According to Soyinka, unquote, "Buhari enslaved the nation. He gloated and glorified in a master-slave relationship to the millions of his inhabitants. It is astonishing to find that the same former slaves, now free of their chains, should clamor to be ruled by one who not only turned their nation into a slave plantation, but forbade them any discussion of their condition." Unquote. Buhari also abolished food subsidies in Nigerian universities and thereby prioritized the introduction of malnutrition into universities. All forms of freedom were restricted and there was vagrant deprivation of fundamental human rights. Decree 2, 1984, the State Detention of Persons Decree, was Buhari's sword of Damocles. Under this decree, journalists were hunted and jailed. More than a dozen press houses were closed down.
The impression that was created in the minds of people in the time of Buhari, especially Buhari and Idiagbo, was that this is the time to be sober, the time not to smile.
There was also the authoritarian Decree 4, under which it was a punishable offense for anyone to publish any material that was deemed as embarrassing to any government official. On the 11th of April, 1984, operatives of the NSL arrested two journalists, Tunde Thompson and Ndukai Rabo of the Guardian newspaper, were brought before a military tribunal and accused of forcefully accusing public officers, even if what the journalists wrote were right. On decree 4, Buhari has remained unrepentant. It did not matter whether the story reported was true or not. If my regime did not like it, the writer will go to jail. Labor unions and professional associations were proscribed and banned. The Nigerian Medical Association, NMA, the National Association of Resident Doctors, National Association of Nigerian Students, and the Academic Staff Union of Universities, ASU, the list was endless. The Nigerian Bar Association, NBA, boycotted all proceedings of Buhari's military tribunals. The World National Security Organization, NSL, Nigeria's first secret police service, which was on hand to intimidate, harass, and detain protesters and demonstrators, students, lecturers, critics and activists, and civil servants who dared embark on strikes. By October 1984, Buhari had retrenched 200,000 Nigerian civil servants. In April 1985, six Nigerians were convicted and condemned to death for drug trafficking by Buhari's special military tribunal, most of them women. Lasukomi Awolala, Oladele Omoshebi, Jimmy Adebayo, Mrs. Sidikat Tyree, Miss Shola Oguntayo, and Gladys Iyama. Gladys Iyama, locked at the Federal Maximum Security Prisons in Kirikiri, was a crippled mother of two paraplegic children and was the first woman in the history of Nigeria to be sentenced to death by firing squad. The Buhari government knew the implication of executing a paralyzed mother of two, and the sentence was secretly approved. The Gloria Okon case was rife. In 1985, Gloria Okon was arrested at the Aminu Kano International Airport on drug trafficking allegations. The case was traced to persons in government who provided security support for their couriers. Gloria Okon was said to have died in detention. The cause of the death was kept secret. To date, Gloria Okon is a mystery dating back to Buhari's days in power. For a man with so much skeletons in his past, Buhari should have been compassionate enough to reach out to families of individuals who were victims of his brutish past and seek genuine restitution. Buhari is part of a past well let alone. Only the future should matter, and nothing about him speaks to Nigeria's future. On the 20th of March 1984, the Buhari Idiagbon regime launched the war against indiscipline.
To little but important everyday manifestations of indiscipline, such as rushing into buses, constituting ourselves into public nuisances, working without commitment, up to this moment, there has been no formal declaration of war against indiscipline. It is my pleasure, therefore, to declare today the launching day for the war against indiscipline.
The problems Idiagbo highlighted were real. The issue was how he and Buhari implemented their campaign. They pursued a brute force and highly physical campaign, which inevitably made them unpopular with ordinary Nigerians.
Many Nigerians will never forget the kabaka or bulala or horse whip lashes that lacerated their backs for not queuing up at bus stations or for even dropping a piece of paper. Soldiers beat up policemen on the streets. Civilians were regularly harassed by uniformed men to the point that they were bloody civilians. Men were forced to do the fresh jump, humiliated in front of their wives and children. Bekololari Ransom Kute, popularly known as Beka, was chairman of the Lagos branch of the Nigerian Medical Association and later its national deputy. In 1984, his brother, Fela, was arrested at the airport as he was preparing to leave for a US tour on what Amnesty International described as spurious charges of illegally exporting foreign currency. Using the new draconian decree that allowed for indefinite detention of political opponents, the government of General Muhammadu Buhari sentenced Fela to 10 years in jail. Ransom Kote, using the Medical Association platform, began a campaign to get the decree revoked and get Fela and all those detained released. But in fact, Beko himself was jailed and only released in 1985. When Buhari was overthrown by General Ibrahim Babangida. Fela Nicolapo Kote wondered why Shehu Shagari was not put on trial by Buhari. Neither was any of the Muslim northern governors of the ruling National Party of Nigeria NPN, except Ape Aku of Benue State, who was a Christian. But governors of the Christian South and other public office holders were jailed. In his inimitable parlance, Fela said, "Driver get accident, na conductor Buhari charge go court." One of Fela's hit songs was based on the disappearance of 2.8 billion naira NNPC money that got stolen under Buhari's watch as petroleum minister and head of the NNPC in 1978.
2.8 billion naira, oil money is missing. 2.8 billion naira, oil money is missing. Then set up inquiry. The same money no lost you. The dabaru everybody.
Under intense public pressure, the Shagari government, which shortly took over thereafter from the military, set up a Senate probe which traced the money to a London Midland bank account belonging to Buhari, from where the money again got missing. It is noteworthy that the value of 2.8 billion naira in 1978 was $3 billion, or in today's naira value, 555 billion naira. Also, General Buhari's reign witnessed the beginning of religious fundamentalism in Nigeria. In February and March 1984, the Maitasili sect, under the leadership of Musa Makanike, unleashed terror on the populace in Yola Adamawa State, and about 1,000 lives were lost. Buhari's Supreme Military Council, January 1984. The makeup of Buhari's Supreme Military Council troubled Southerners. Virtually all of the senior positions in the Supreme Military Council were occupied by Northern Muslims. Of the 16 members of Buhari's ruling Supreme Military Council, 11 were from the north, while 5 came from the south, with only Commodore Ebitu Ukiwe representing the southeast, and Brigadier Ola Oni from Lagos, who represented the southwest. Against the background of the judicial murder of Owo, Ogedengbe, and Ojualape, one can understand the Sharia mindset of General Buhari. Even his actions predate that of the Taliban, a living modern-day apostle of the Hammurabi's code of law. An eye for an eye. There was the case of Buhari's deliberate humiliating treatment of the then Emir of Kano, Alhaji Adobayero, and Obasijuade, the Oni of Ife, over their visit to the State of Israel. This royal duo went to Israel on their private steelman private business. Since when, one may ask, did a free citizen of the Nigerian nation require the permission of a head of state to visit a foreign nation that was willing to offer that tourist a visa? The humiliation of Adobayero and the Oni of Ife demonstrates Buhari's total lack of respect for our traditional rulers and his gross disdain for what our traditional institutions stand for. Ayabe Soyinka, the renowned journalist and author of Diplomatic Baggage, Mossad and Nigeria, the Deco Story, published in 1994, wrote, unquote, "The Buhari government, in prosecuting its war on corruption, gave the National Security Organization, NSO, unprecedented powers of arrest and detention. The regime promulgated the State Security Detention of Persons Decree No. 2 of 1984, which gave the NSO the power to detain anyone suspected to be a security risk indefinitely. On the 5th of July 1984, a team of Nigerian security operatives led by Major Mohammed Yusuf and the Israeli Casas were on hand to kidnap and bundle back to Nigeria Umaru Diko. Umaru Diko was drugged and put into a crate that was labeled as Diplomatic Baggage. An empty Nigerian Airways Boeing 707 plane was already waiting at the London Stansted Airport, waiting for him to be extradited back to Nigeria. He was abducted right in front of his home and put in a van and driven to the airport, where he was passed off as diplomatic luggage from the Nigerian embassy. Diko said in an interview with the BBC in 1985, unquote, "I remember the very violent way in which I was grabbed and hauled into a van with a huge fellow sitting on my head, and the way in which they immediately put on me handcuffs and chains on my legs. The Nigerian Airways crew was detained. Buhari responded by ordering a British Caledonia plane that was already in the air, flying from Lagos to London via Kano, to be returned back to Lagos, where it was also detained by the Nigerian authorities. Immediately, the United Kingdom released the Nigerian Airways crew. Buhari also freed the British plane to fly back to London. 17 men were arrested and 4 of them were later sentenced to years ranging from 10 to 14 years. All of them were later released after spending 6 to 8.5 years in jail and were silently deported. Buhari retaliated too by promptly picking up 2 British engineers in Nigeria and slamming 14-year prison sentences on them. To get Umaru Diko, Buhari turned to an Israeli businessman and a con man known as Elisha Cohen. Mr. Cohen, who had originally come to Nigeria in the 60s, was a representative of Reynolds, a subsidiary of the Israeli construction company Sole Bonaire. And while in Nigeria, he became friends with a lot of military officers like Obasanjo, with whom he did a lot of business. Buhari gave Mr. Cohen $5 million, and with Rafindadi, who was the head of the NSO, and Major General Haladu Hananiya, the Nigerian High Commissioner to Britain, and Group Captain Bernard Bamfa, the Managing Director of the Nigerian Airways, they hatched the plot to kidnap Diko.
Did your government plan this kidnapping? Why was one of your officials at Stansted Airport last night?
I'm not aware of that.
You're not aware, but it was one of your officials.
I wasn't aware.
Why is the aircraft, the British Caledonian aircraft, held in Nigeria?
I'm not aware of that one. Ask the Minister of...
What did you tell the Minister
Despite
General?
Despite the High Commissioner's denials, 17 people, most of them Nigerians, are now being questioned about the kidnapping. 14 are being held at the high-security Paddington Green police station.
Most of the 14 are Nigerians, but 2 are believed to be Israeli mercenaries who were found inside crates of Stansted last night with Mr. Diko. The entire crew of a Nigerian freight plane that should have been leaving Stansted last night is also being questioned. Paul Davis, News at 1, Paddington Green Police Station.
The disgraceful incident took Nigeria's reputation into a tailspin worldwide.
Disaffection with Buhari had been evident for months, and his removal somehow was expected. At a parade like this, he and his colleagues survived at least one assassination attempt by 42 army officers.
Well, Buhari has not delivered the goods. He has not been able to decide on what to do with the detainees from Shehu Shagari's previous regime. He has not come up with a comprehensive economic policy. He has built himself into a corner.
In the words of Peter Inaro, unquote, the two terrors began to construct the Nigeria of their vision. Fascism without the Hitler straight arm salute. Among their emphatic achievements was the execution of a female convict by a firing squad, a first by a military regime in Nigeria. The scope of state violence and the innovation of absurdly long prison sentences imposed by the courts frightened and disgusted most Nigerians. The regime shot itself in the foot when it recruited international brigands to carry out a gangland-style operation coordinated by a Nigerian army major in London, unquote. It is on record that Buhari's tribunals sentenced their victims to terms ranging from 100 to 600 years in jail. On January 14, 2007, Nobel laureate Wole Soyinka laid down reasons why Buhari doesn't deserve to be president. Unquote. In Buhari, we have been offered no evidence of the surest prospect of change. On the contrary, all evidence suggests that this is one individual who remains convinced that this is one ex-ruler that the nation cannot call to order. Buhari was one of the generals who treated a commission of inquiry, the Oputa panel, with unconcealed disdain. Soyinka went on to describe the execution of Owo, Ogedengbe and Ojulakpe as nothing short of premeditated murder. Soyinka further added, unquote, since leaving office, Buhari has declared in the most categorical terms that he had no regrets over this murder and would do so again. In 1999, Obasanjo set up a management investigation panel to probe the activities of PTF under General Buhari. In the report of the investigative committee, it was revealed that the Afri Projects Consortium, APC, were contracted by PTF as management and project consultants. Buhari, as executive chairman of PTF, delegated them the power of engineer in all appropriate projects requiring such power. Afri Project Consortium, APC, then assumed absolute powers of initiation, approval and execution of all projects. To corroborate this, a PTF trustee, Group Captain Usman Jibril, remarked that, unquote, Buhari brought in the late Ahmad Salhijo, his in-law, without informing us. He just saw these boys in the meeting. We asked him, who are these boys? He said they were just helping him take notes. We didn't know that he had engaged them as consultants without our knowledge and consent because we are all members. I told him that it was wrong. As trustees, if anything went wrong, we were the people that were prosecuted, not any other person. I asked them to change the procedure and they were not ready to change it. I said, okay, bye-bye, unquote. Sally Hijo, who was curiously reported dead the very day a committee was set up to probe the PTF, was the owner of Afri Projects Consortium, APC. APC was indicted for overcharging the PTF for up to about 25 billion naira by the Interim Management Committee and for also importing substandard, soon-to-be-expired drugs at overinflated prices. This calls to question the ability of General Muhammadu Buhari to manage the Nigerian economy and fight corruption if elected president. In the weekend of January 11, 2015, these day newspapers reportedly got exclusive hold of the original copy of a report by the Petroleum Special Trust Fund PTF Interim Management Committee, instituted on July 7, 1999 by the former President Olusegun Obasanjo. By the time it was being disbanded by President Obasanjo in 1999, records show that the APC, Afri Projects Consortium, have collected 181,795,000,000 naira, and that Ahmed Salihijo, Buhari's brother-in-law, was his front at the organization. Buhari was the Tsar of this empire, but it was a clear case of the voice of Jacob and the hands of Esau. Although the 2011 election was deemed the cleanest so far since Nigeria's return to democracy in 1999, it was also, according to Human Rights Watch, among the bloodiest. And it is widely acknowledged that this is as a result of the fact that supporters of Buhari let loose the dogs of war. Over 800 Nigerians lay dead, and about 65,000 more were displaced. Much of the violence occurred in northern states when protests by Buhari supporters degenerated into violent riots or sectarian killings. Deadline, May 14, 2012. While speaking to supporters in Kaduna, Muhammadu Buhari said, unquote, "If what happened in 2011 should again happen in 2015, by the grace of God, the dog and the baboon will all be soaked in blood." In this context, Buhari's suggestion that 2015 could be violent cannot be taken lightly. Buhari's stance and antecedents on Sharia law for Nigeria are also so well documented. Buhari is credited with statements such like, unquote, "Christians should not worry when Muslims chop off their own hands and hands in the name of Sharia because it is none of their business." Or, "Muslims should only vote for Muslims," or, "for those that will protect their interest," unquote. Major General Muhammadu Buhari attended the Lagos State Interdenominational Thanksgiving Service with his running mate, Professor Yemi Osibanjo, the General Overseer of the Redeemed Christian Church of God, Pastor Enoch Adeboye, and Governor Babatunde Fashola. All these men had their wives by their sides except Buhari. For a man who preaches change and desires to rule a country made up of men and women in almost equal halves, it is an anomaly to have an invincible wife. Interestingly, this is not the first time that Mrs. Aisha Buhari would have been left behind in her husband's aspiration. In 2003, she was not prominent when Buhari ran against Obasanjo. Buhari lost. 4 years later, when Buhari ran against Umaru Yar'Adua, nothing changed. Buhari lost. In 2011, Buhari lost. This is not a coincidence. Not for a man who sentenced a crippled mother of two children to death by firing squad. In an interview on Liberty FM Radio Kaduna on Sunday, June 2, 2013, Buhari has this to say, unquote, "While the Niger Delta were treated like kings, the Jamaatu Al-Hisuna leader Awatiwa Jihad, which some people call Boko Haram, are being killed and their houses destroyed, unlike the special treatment given to the Niger Delta militants. This is injustice to northern Nigeria." Buhari is a man who would seek power but abdicate responsibility when he gets it, and the facts don't lie. General Igiagbon personified nearly everything associated with the Buhari regime. In a similar vein, when General Buhari was appointed by General Sani Abacha as Executive Chairman of the Petroleum Special Trust Fund PTF from 1994 to 1999, he did not take any personal charge of much of what happened throughout the period. Instead, he ceded his authority to a firm of consultants, Afri Projects Consortium, APC, a firm owned by Buhari's brother-in-law. APC was given exclusive powers to initiate projects, assess and approve their probable cost, execute the projects, assess the quality of execution, all without any higher supervision. Once again, General Buhari's lack of capacity to take responsibility was amply demonstrated when, after his nomination as the presidential candidate of the All Progressive Congress, APC, he couldn't immediately choose a running mate. Characteristically, Buhari ceded the responsibility for choosing a running mate to another national leader of the party, Asiwaju Bola Ahmed Tinubu. In three consecutive elections, Nigerians have said they do not want Muhammadu Buhari to be their president. But Buhari simply refuses to take no for an answer. But how honorable and loyal is the man Buhari? It is a veiled curiosity that he hardly keeps faith with his political partners and friends, a character trait which might question loyalty and trust. Since 2003, he has been in the APP, the ANPP, the CPC, and now the APC. The curious characteristics of a political journeyman. Buhari will be 73 years old in 2015. If he is voted president and he runs for a second term in office, he will be president even at the age of 81 years. So for a man who was first head of state at the age of 41, that equates a period spanning 40 years. Let's stop a minute and ask, does Buhari possess the temperament to be Nigeria's president in a globalized 21st century? Former Minister of the Federal Capital Territory, FCT, Malam Nasri El-Rufai, and present APC governorship candidate for Kaduna State, wrote in a public letter in October 2010 that Buhari remains, unquote, perpetually unelectable, and that Buhari's insensitivity to Nigeria's diversity and his parochial focus are already well known, unquote. Curiously today, barely 4 years later, El-Rufai's APC wants Nigerians to ride on Buhari's insensitivity and celebrate his parochial narrow-mindedness. It is obvious, Buhari will destroy Nigeria now, just as he did 30 years ago. The rain may beat the leopard, but it cannot wash away its spots.
But Buhari pull over. Buhari pull over. Reverse, Buhari pull over. Buhari pull over. Show me your certificate or your pull over. Buhari pull over. No deceivers, Buhari pull over. Buhari pull over. Back, Buhari pull over. Buhari pull over. Reverse, Buhari pull over. Buhari pull over. Show me your certificate or your pull over. Buhari pull over. No they wash us, Buhari pull over.